Thank you so much for coming. You would have seen on the advert that we are talking today about Black African Lives Matter and decolonizing the academy. And we have two speakers today, but before I introduce them, let me go a bit over what we are going to be discussing today. You would have seen from the advertisements for this seminar that we are making connections between a number of events. Some of them, unfortunately, deaths of African or African-American or Black Britons people. We've talked about Kofi Edubempong, who was shot in the University of Florida, Julian Cole in Britain, Freddie Gray in Baltimore. But we also make connections to the deaths of hundreds of African migrants in the Mediterranean Sea. We talk about protest of students, high school students in Pretoria in South Africa. And then even reach back 70 years ago to the deaths of Sergeant Ajete, Corporal Atiko, and Private Odachi Lamte, who were murdered by colonial officers for standing up and for seeking independence from forms of oppression. So the question is, what is the connections between these events and even the fact that, as we have here, Ghana spends over $1.5 billion on food imports. The point is that structures of power that underpin these forms of oppression are similar across geographies. They are linked to racism and slavery and colonialism and neocolonialism. So the question then is, what do we do in the academy to make these connections explicit, because they are not always. For instance, many of us might look on social media and read about things happening, say, in the United States with the Black Lives Matter movement. But I've only seen one explicit organized protest in support of the Black Lives movement on the African continent, and that was in South Africa. I haven't seen any suggestion in Ghana, for instance, that we should go and march on the streets in support of African-American brothers and sisters. So what do in these institutions in a place like the University of Ghana, where we are supposed to produce knowledge? What do to make explicit these connections? What is our role as producers of knowledge, and particularly African-centered knowledge, in these kinds of struggles? And what is the place of academic freedom in these kinds of discussions? We have our own struggle going on right now in regards to the Gandhi statue, and there have been suggestions that we shouldn't be having those kinds of conversations. Is this a question of academic freedom or not? So this is basically what we want to do on this panel today, to talk about these kinds of interconnections and to talk about our roles as intellectuals, whether within the academy or not. And to have that discussion, to lead us in that discussion, we have two persons, Professor Kusi Adumankwampofo and Dr. Obadele Kamwo. So thank you again for coming, and I'll hand straight away to Professor Adumankwampofo.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nyiduo, and good morning to everyone.
I am on sabbatical leave,
so it's very exciting to be back home
and pass through the Institute of African Studies
with friends and colleagues, and look forward to a very vibrant discussion this morning. As you were coming in, you probably heard the song by Dr. Ephraim Amu playing, and there were little snippets of his bio that were available to us. This is somebody who many years ago stood here in this institute in our country and also spoke up for African knowledge systems, for the rights of African and Black peoples, and was willing to sacrifice comfort and position and title in order to create that space for us. On the slide before you, you'll see on the extreme left, that's a picture of Kofi Edubempong, who was a PhD student at the University of Florida. He was shot in his own home by University of Florida police. Somebody had called. This is a student who had mental health issues and was crying, making a sound. And 911 was called. Why the police were the ones who entered his home till today is difficult for people to understand. And we see him here in the picture. Some years later, after this incident in 2010, I think this picture was taken in 2012, when he was still undergoing treatment, police barged into his apartment and claimed that he was holding a weapon and shot him 7 times in the head. At a demonstration in London in May 2015, picket signs called the name of Julian Cole, the 21-year-old black Briton who was in a vegetative state since 2013, when police allegedly left him with spinal injuries very similar to those that Freddie Gray suffered in Baltimore in the back of a truck. These days, you all have your iPads and your phones here, so fact-finding is easy. Anything that I say here, you can go into Google and fact-find and see whether what I'm saying is true. For Edu Primpong, a movie that has been made about his life is called In His Own Home. At Berlin's May Day parade in 2015, that's the picture you see on the bottom left, activists with Berlin's Ferguson is Everywhere campaign distributed signs emblazoned with the names of people of color killed by German police. There's a sense that this attack on black bodies is only happening in North America or in the United States. It's happening globally, and this is why these examples are being unearthed. And then of course we heard that African migrants are being killed daily, and I use the word killed advisedly, because even though some of the migrants do make it across to the other side, we find that the reception that awaits them is really one that is asking for these people to die some kind of a death. I'd like to play a video clip for you, just take you back to 1971, when many people in this room were not born, but I was a young person in this country, and there was a festival here. Is anyone here old enough to remember the festival that was here held in 71 that linked the lives of black people, basically in North America, but also in Ghana? And this was an amazing...
Africa, everything happens, and the experience becomes a major motion picture event.
That's my head, Tina Turner.
Can you please help me?
Wilson
Pickett. My soul ain't nothing but a feeling.
To link black lives across the world were much deeper then than they are today. I was 11 years old, just on my way to Form 1, and I pleaded with my parents that I wanted to go, and my mother took me for most of the event. Sadly, we've come to a place where we think that these connections are sorry, give me a moment to just get the slide up. We think that these connections are no more important. So this is what I want to do in the remaining time that I have, to suggest that there are certain things, experiences that we are going through today that may not be the deaths of people like Edu Brimpong, but are slow deaths that are annihilating black bodies globally. I will, depending on how much time I have, I might skip some of that journey, to tell us about the study of African and Africana peoples that didn't start today, with the incidents and the location of institutes and centers of African studies. And then I want to talk a little bit about, so what do some of the things that I will share with you mean for us within the academy? So, you know, we hear about how much we are importing, spending to import food, so what, you know, why should we care? Dr. Kambon will tell us at length about some of our heroes and sheroes that many of us don't even know about. And myself, I have been on a journey to understand some of the forefathers and foremothers who have brought us to this place. There's a book here called The Mind of Africa by Professor Abraham that was given to me some years ago. And I knew about him, I had heard of him, but I had never read his work. And I have spent much of the last year, including my parents, who also flipped through the book and were like, wow, this is amazing. And I don't know, I wonder how many people in this room have heard of him, let alone have read his work. And then we'll conclude by suggesting how we might want to do knowledge production if we think that all that we hear makes a difference and that there's something that we can do within the academy. So I'm going to run through some examples of what I am claiming are these slow deaths. We know at the moment that Haiti is suffering because of Hurricane Matthew. What many of you may not know about Haiti's history, that it was built on the back of black slave labor, in the then French colony of Saint Dominique, that there was a successful Haitian revolution led by anti-slavery and anti-colonial peoples of black descent, slaves, in other words, former slaves. They founded the sovereign state of Haiti, and then they were crippled by debt. Why? Because in 1825, France came with warships to the coast of Haiti, which had found independence through its own struggles, and demanded that Haiti compensate it for what? For the loss of slaves and the slave colony. Basically, Haiti was to compensate former slave owners for the loss of their slaves. In exchange for the French not blowing Haiti to pieces, France demanded a payment of 150 million francs. According to Wikipedia, this, the modern equivalent of that is $21 billion. In 1838, France agreed to reduce the debt to 90 million francs to be paid over a period of 30 years. Haiti had a total external debt of $1.8 billion at its peak, and it took Haiti 120 years until 1947 to pay off both the original debt plus the tens of millions more in interest that they borrowed from French banks to pay the French people for the loss of their slaves. In 2015, President Hollande was the first French president to visit Haiti and spoke of the moral debt, and of course, interestingly, was silent about the issue of a cash debt. We can speak about Haiti's poor leaders, and rightly so, but the subsequent treatment of Haiti by the world has been abysmal, abominable at best. For example, the January 2010 earthquake that hit Haiti exposed us to the rot in the world's charities. Well-meaning people and their governments donated about $12 billion of emergency aid, virtually none of which reached individual Haitians. The funds that were delivered went mostly to enrich the donor countries, government agencies, aid agencies, and non-governmental organizations. And the vast majority of the pledged funds were never delivered at all. Some of this disappeared money was embezzled. And two criminal cases in 2015 give us a glimpse into the use of how NGOs, networks, launder embezzled money. Some of these cases are being tried in in Greece and in Italy. Interestingly, although France could demand compensation for the loss of its slaves, the demands made by former colonies to Europe and North America for reparations are dismissed with the argument that the crimes of slavery and colonialism were committed by their ancestors. In other words, the people today are not culpable for their sins of their grandparents. If we accept the logic of this argument, that the responsibility of crimes is not for the descendants, then we must also conclude that the great wealth reaped from those crimes, which facilitated the building of Europe and North America, does also not belong to the descendants, and that money should be reparated back to the people who were stolen from. The picture that you see, the picture on the extreme left is Haiti going through some of its struggles, and of course, apparently also African mafia. You see a picture of Twining's tea and what I think is the most amazing tea that comes from Kenya. And many of us in this room are in and out of airports a lot. I wonder the last time you saw Kericho Gold tea in any duty-free shop. On the bottom, we've got Hershey's chocolate and our own King's Bite. Again, I wonder how many times you've gone through a duty-free shop and found Golden Tree in there. Meanwhile, the Americans don't grow cocoa, and neither do the British produce tea. And I don't. So why is it that when we think of tea, these are the places that we think of? And when we want chocolate, we want Hershey's chocolate, and we're not thinking of King's Bite. Poultry. Some may remember poultry farmers' anger in this country. Poultry leftovers rejected by European consumers find their way to African markets, way cheaper than our homegrown birds, thereby killing the local industry. Third World Network and others have long called on our government not to sign the Interim Economic Partnership for Africa program, and then subsequently the EPA itself, as it harms the majority of Ghanaian producers and consumers, not only financially, but health-wise. Because these chickens, seriously, who wants to eat this kind of stuff, really? In 2014, the managing director of the Ghana Netherlands Chamber of Commerce, Nico van Schalwin, was cited as cautioning Ghana not to consider banning the importation of chicken. And I quote him. I found this on the City FM online website. "I used to work in the poultry industry," this Dutchman says, "for more than 20 years, and I am warning Ghana. Ghana is not an ideal country for the production of chicken. Don't jump to whatever you see. Look at what Ghana's strong points are. Export that. Develop cassava, goats, and maize, and develop rice that belongs here. But stay away from the risky business chicken." What do we eat today? Fried rice and chicken. And food scientists assure us that our diet has become awful for our health. 80% of our fish is imported because we've spoiled the waters close to the coast and have given the others away. E-waste. Ghana has the dubious distinction of the largest dump, carrying the waste of all the PCs, laptops, cell phones that the West no longer wants. And they litter our ecosystem and kill us. The United Nations estimates over 50 million tons of e-waste is generated globally each year. In the US alone, e-waste, it is estimated that 30 to 40 million PCs become obsolete. Where obsolete means there's a funky new PC, and so I've got to throw my old one away. The creation of this huge volume of e-waste is not matched by appropriate means of disposal. And this has become a daunting challenge to more industrialized nations. So one solution is send it over to poorer countries and give them a little bit of money for it. Or use the language, and this is where the academy comes in, because we imbibe this language. Use the language of bridging the digital gap to suggest to us that we don't have enough computers, so we're going to donate them to some poor school somewhere. And of course, by the time you've changed the motherboard and changed this and changed that, you might as well have thrown that computer away to begin with. Now, our own Institute for Environment and Sanitation Studies here on this campus tells us that the young people who are at Agogoshi trying to pull these computers apart to take out the parts that can be reused and resold, these are some of the diseases that we can expect. Disruption of cell growth, cardiovascular diseases, cancer, diabetes, bone pain, severely weakened overall your body just malfunctioning. Skin irritation, rashes, throat irritations, the lungs, liver, and kidney are affected. Lead poisoning, and we know that the dangers of lead poisoning, which causes a whole slew of other problems. So, what about our history? And a brief word on Gandhi. Last week, I was giving a talk to some young people, and I mentioned that I had once worked as a research assistant for Professor Bennett. They have no idea who Professor Bennett is. And I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you to raise your hands in this room. They had no idea who Professor Akila Pasoya was. They had no idea who Professor Adai Mensa was. These are recent vice chancellors in this country. When we teach Introduction to African Studies and we give students a map of Africa and ask them to put the countries on, forget about even the capitals. You will find somebody putting Liberia where Rwanda is, Cameroon down in Botswana. And these are students of Africa, students in Africa. Ask them to tell you where the United States is and they will be able to put it on the map. Almost 70 years after Sergeant Ajete, Corporal Tipu and Private Odate Lamte were murdered by colonial officers for seeking independence, not a single statue commemorating them stands anywhere. I knew that Sergeant Ajete could be found in Labadi, so yesterday I went to La to try, well, actually, truth be told, I asked my husband to go to La. And he went to La and came back and showed me what he was able to find. The site of where Ajete was is now empty, and he can't be found. It's under your e-waste, under the chicken, I'm sorry, is where Ajete used to stand, and I have no idea, this was yesterday, so there's no way for me to do any fact-finding. So Ajete is gone. This is a website of an Indian group who have themselves protested long about the removal of Gandhi. And there's an author called G.B. Singh who has written a text called Gandhi Under Cross-Examination, which has unearthed a lot of Gandhi's earlier writings that we were not exposed to. I also grew up thinking that Gandhi was a hero. But when new information becomes available to you, you've got to rethink what you know. So what we know about Gandhi's anti-violence stand, and here are some quotes from Gandhi himself, 1899 to 1902, the Second Boer War in South Africa. I need hardly say that as soon as war was declared, irrespective of their opinions as to the justness or otherwise of the war, the Indians to a man made up their minds to give their humble support to the British government during the crisis. Prior to Gandhi's arrival in South Africa, the Black Zulu South Africans were in the middle of a non-violent civil rights movement against their colonial British masters. They refused to pay taxes and so on. And Gandhi's response, and here's another quote from him, "It is not for us to say whether the revolt of the Kaffirs is justified or not. We are in Natal by virtue of British power. Our very existence depends upon it. It is therefore our duty to render whatever help we can. There was a discussion in the press as to what part the Indian community would play in the event of an actual war. We have already declared in the English columns of this journal that the Indian community is ready to play its part. We need to know that we've got the Afrikaners and we've got the British. And the Indians and Gandhi were supporting the British. In whatever it was like, okay, these bad Afrikaners, but we will support the British in whatever it is that they are doing in South Africa." We also have quotes that suggest to us that he was also not immune to the charms of Hitler. So here again is Gandhi on May 15, 1940. "I do not consider Hitler to be as bad as he is depicted. He is showing an ability that is amazing and he seems to be gaining his victories without much bloodshed." Unquote. Later that year, on December 24th, he began a letter to Hitler with, quote, "Dear friend," and continued, "that I address you as a friend is no formality." He then told the German leader, "We have no doubt about your bravery or devotion to your fatherland, nor do we believe that you are the monster described by your opponents." Unquote. As for Gandhi's racist comments, just a few, I'm just going to give you maybe one or two. And this is all written when he was in South Africa. This one in 1896. "Ours is one continual struggle against a degradation sought to be inflicted upon us by the Europeans, who desire to degrade us to the level of the raw Kaffir, whose occupation is hunting and whose sole ambition is to collect a certain number of cattle to buy a wife with, and then pass his life in indolence and nakedness. unquote. It is not just the term kafir, but it is his description and his attitude to people who are of African, indigenous Africans. Why of all places, Gandhi asks, in Johannesburg, the Indian location, should it be chosen for dumping down all the kafirs of the town, passes my comprehension. Of course, under my suggestion, the town council must withdraw the kafirs from the location. About this mixing of the kafirs with the Indians, I must confess, I feel most strongly. I think it is very unfair to the Indian population, and it is an undue tax on even the proverbial patience of my countrymen. One final one, and we might, there's a slew of them, and you might read the actual text. We have to learn much from what the whites are doing in Natal. There's hardly any family from which someone has not gone to fight the Kafir rebels. Following their example, we should steel our hearts and take courage. Now is the time when the leading whites want us to take this step. If we let go this opportunity, we shall repent later. We therefore urge all Indian leaders to do their duty to the best of their ability. Unquote. What does all of this mean for us within the academy? Despite the large body of work by African philosophers, we don't know them. We know Socrates and Aristotle and Kant and whoever. I earlier on asked how many people, to my own shame, I had not read this book by Professor Abraham until 2 years ago. It was given to me. Even major texts on globalization fail to give Africa serious consideration. Some of Africa's most rigorous analysis are reduced to futile protest literature, like we're all responding and complaining. According to a 2003 publication by Zeleza, a Malawian historian, only less than 5% of the world's scientific publications come from Africa. Of course, a major problem here is who is counting and what is being counted as being scientific. This is being determined by journals somewhere else. And then we are also chasing those journals because our own institutions say if we don't publish there, then we're not going to get promoted. I remember when I was on the appointments board some years ago, and I remember having a discussion about the valorization of textbooks. And the then Pro Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Professor Osam, was like, why aren't we giving more value to the textbooks that we are writing? It's like, no, it should be journals, and it should be, you know, academic presses, and it should be peer reviewed. And so we're not valorizing textbooks. So people are like, okay, if I'm going to get promoted and textbooks are not in there, I won't write textbooks. So of course, when we are teaching, whose textbooks are we then using? Other people's texts. And they are then telling us what we should be teaching our students about ourselves. We can talk about representations. We can talk about the aid industry and people constantly telling us what our problems are and what they have to do for us. And there is no time to go into that, but I would like to read Nkrumah's quote that is cited on the slide before you, which is in a 1962 text, and these are words that he gave at the first Congress of Africanists here at the University of Ghana. If Africa's interest is interpreted in terms of the interest of European merchandise and capital, it is no wonder that African nationalism is regarded as a perversion and colonialism as a virtue. If we have lost touch with what our forefathers knew, this has been due to the system of education to which we have been introduced. This system of education prepared us for a subservient role to Europe and things European. It was directed at estranging us from our own cultures, the more effectively to serve a new and alien interest, unquote. Why is it that concepts that are developed elsewhere are thrown at us and we imbibe them and take them up in its light? What does it mean when we talk about a failed state? Yesterday I was talking two days ago, to Dr. Edward Nambigni, who is here. They did a study among young girls and found that there were young women whose boyfriends gave them sanitary pads. And the people they were working with from the other side of the ocean over there said, oh, this is transactional sex. And Dr. Nambigni says, no, we've not explored whether this is transactional sex. Don't boyfriends give their girlfriends gifts everywhere in the world? Why is it that if a young boy gives a gift to his girlfriend in Africa, he can't be giving it to her because he loves her, but it's got to be transactional sex, and she's sleeping it with him just because she needs something? So these are concepts that are thrown around. And from my own work, I could come up with zillions. That at one point, I learned in the classroom and took them, and it's like, I'm going to work with this. And then suddenly, you are talking to real human beings on the ground, and you're like, this doesn't make sense to any part of my reality. So we'll come back to conclusions. And do I still have a minute? I have 1 minute, okay. So before I hand the mic over to Dr. Kambon, let me just say that there have been many critiques of development, you know, and yet somehow we continue to use this notion of how the world is understood somewhere to measure our own experience. And typically these theories are formulated somewhere and handed down to us. What has been referred to as the colonial library, and what this morning we want to say here needs to be dismantled. That colonial library does not work for our experience. Things need to be different. And the ideas that are passed on to us don't impact just what we learn in the classroom, but they impact our policies, because we take them and then we design these policies that don't fit our reality. We are also hampered by this notion that we need to make education useful and market-oriented, but education really, not that you shouldn't get a job, of course you should get a job, but education is supposed to open the recesses of your mind so that you can think critically and make a contribution to the society that you come from. We are very interested, as I said, in these valorizations, knowledge production, where we should publish, who should give us the right to publish, where internationalization, we are obsessed with rankings. And all of this leads us to the kinds of stories that I talked about at the beginning of my presentation. And I will come back in a few minutes. Thank you very much.
To deal with, again, Black equals African Lives Matter. Now, as you know, when I do my presentations, I always do it with a call and response. So in this case, when I say Black, I want you to say Lives Matter. Black?
Lives Matter.
African?
Lives Matter.
Very good. And we'll be mentioning the names of several of our illustrious ancestors. So when I do that, I'll be pouring a libation as we mention the name. All right, now you were wondering, okay, Dr. Kambon, anytime he does a presentation, he pours libation. We do not leave it behind. So we'll go ahead and get started. On the left-hand side, you see Jet, that is eternity in the sense of space. Then on the right-hand side, you see Nehem, which is eternity in the sense of time. So let's move forward. So this is Carter G. Woodson. And in it, he talks about two educations. And he says, every man has two educations, that which is given to him, and the other, that which he gives himself. Of the two kinds, the latter is by far the more desirable. Indeed, all that is most worthy in man, he must work out and conquer for himself. It is that which constitutes our real and best nourishment. What we are merely taught seldom nourishes the mind like that which we teach ourselves. Carter G. Woodson. Let's say, yeah.
Yeah.
Very good, let's continue. Now, Harriet Tubman referred, emancipate yourself from mental slavery. And she says, I freed thousands of slaves. I could have freed thousands more if they had known they were slaves. So now we're going to meet some of the mental slave masters. Now, in terms of history, what you see at the bottom left is the oldest historical document in the face of the entire planet Earth, what's called the Scorpion Tableau. Put that in your notes, Scorpion Tableau, so you can follow up. Now, in the middle, you see Jehuti Mes, also called Thutmose III. And in this is the high point of historical documentation in ancient times. And look at the dates, 3250 BCE, 1481 BCE. However, we don't hear those names. What do we hear? We hear Herodotus as the father of history. Now, can a child give birth to his own father? Which came first, the chicken or the egg? This is our question. So here, we are talking about Black, African. Let's continue. We also mentioned Heru and Akhenaten. Yeah. So in this, Heru is the blueprint for what you know as Jesus, right? And this is the original image. Akhenaten is known as the father of monotheism, right? Now, Akhenaten, we don't hear that name, but why is that? And it would also interest you to know that Caesar Borgia was the template of Jesus. And he didn't live until the 1400s. So before that, you had all these images of the Black Madonna and Child all throughout Europe. And there are over 450 to 500 images of the original Black ones still in Europe throughout there. Let's continue. Imhotep, the world's first multi-genius. He worked in architecture, medicine, also worked in mathematics. He was also a politician, achieving the highest office in the entire land, rising up the ranks from a commoner. This is Imhotep. Yeah. Now, how come we don't hear about Imhotep? When you look at Imhotep, it should be very clear, because he's blacker than most of us in this room, right? But we want to see the original images, not the images of him from the Greek period or the Roman period. We want to go to the original images. But do we hear about Imhotep? Do we see Imhotep? Or do we know Einstein? No water for you, Einstein. Hesi-Ra, 2650 CE, also noted as the first physician in the history of the entire world. Why do we not hear his name? Well, when you look at his face, it should be very clear why you don't hear his name, because he looks exactly like you. So this is Hesi-Ra, 2650 CE. However, to this date, we cite the Hippocratic Oath. And it would interest you that in the Hippocratic Oath, it says we swear by Asclepius, which is the Greek name for Imhotep. So Hesi-Ra, yeah. Harjadef, this is the oldest writing in the history of the entire planet Earth, the instructions of Harjadef. It only exists in a fragmentary form. Now, has anyone heard of Harjadef? But have we heard of Socrates? This is what we call miseducation, diseducation, and anti-education. And it's not your own fault. This is intentional. Once you make sure people don't know about themselves, then you can make sure that they will think the things that they think. So hard to death?
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, Aset. This is the original, what you call Virgin Mary. Now you can look at her, degeneration from Aset on the far left, to the Black Madonna and Child in the middle, to what you now know as Mary and Jesus. Again, 450 to 500 of these in Europe. You can read Christianity Before Christ by John Jackson for more information. So the original virgin birth and divine savior, Aset. Yeah. Kagemni, the next oldest writing. So Kagemni also had the instructions where we have the very final portion, but this is again only in fragmentary form. So we don't hear about Kagemni, but we hear about Plato. When you look at the two, it should be very clear the reason why. So, Kagemni.
Yeah.
Let's continue. Ptahotep, this is the oldest surviving book in the history of the entire planet Earth, before China, before Mesopotamia. When you look at him, do you notice any similarity? Very good. Now, how come we don't hear about the author of the world's oldest book in the history of the entire planet Earth, but I think we've heard of Shakespeare. Anyone? When you look at the two, it should be very clear. So, Ptahotep.
Yeah.
Wenis, this is the author of what is called the Pyramid Text, the oldest religious text in the history of the entire planet Earth that all other religious texts plagiarize from. Now, in academia, you're not supposed to do plagiarism, but when you go to the idea of a savior, death and resurrection of that savior, all of these things, Immaculate Conception, all of them are found carved in stone in pyramids in the Pyramid of Wenis. We don't hear about him, but we hear about King James. So no water for you, James, but water for you, Wenis.
Yeah.
Peshet, the first woman in medicine on the face of the implant in the entire earth. Now, if you can turn to a profile view, look. Yeah. You notice any similarity with our share? But we hear about Florence Nightingale. One of my colleagues said, yes, Florence Nightingale, she invented modern nursing, right? So when you look at the two, it should be very clear why you didn't hear about Peshet, even though she preceded Florence Nightingale by a good, let's say, 4,000 years. And we're saying maybe we can get women in medicine. When someone tells you that, they don't know anything about their history, and that's intentional. So Peshet?
Yeah.
Black?
Life.
African?
Life.
Now you can't fall asleep in an IES seminar. I know you do this in other seminars, but not here. Your colleague will wake you. So Merikare, talking about human nature and social relations. Now, we don't hear about Merikare, but he talks about what Seth Antijoke also talked about in the two cradle theory in terms of explaining why Eurasians behave the way that they behave. He goes into resources, all of these things. Now, we don't hear about Merikare, but we hear about Karl Marx. And people would be interested to read what Marx and Engels, White Races, the proletarian outlook of Marxism, all of the quotes that we got from Gandhi, we will get the same quotes from Marx. Also saying that African people had no history because he didn't know it himself. But we will give water to Merikare.
Yeah.
No water to Marx. I have thirst. So Sobek-Neferu, the first female ruler in the history of the entire planet, even though there are some from even the first dynasty where it's disputed whether they ruled outright, but definitely Sobek-Neferu did. We don't hear about Sobek-Neferu. When you look at her, it's very clear, but we hear about Elizabeth. So water for Sobek-Neferu?
Yeah.
Sanhat, the oldest literature on the face of the planet, the world's first epic, where he leaves Kemet, goes into southwestern Asia, and comes back. Ayinkwe Alma and his collective, Per-Amp, he doesn't like me to mention his name. He says it's just a collective. But you can actually read this in Fanti. You can read this in Wolof, in Kiswahili, IsiZulu. It's a multilingual translation. So if you want to read your ancient texts, you can go there and read it. Homer is unknown. Did he even exist, or were these just attributed to a mythical figure? But we hear about Homer, we don't hear about Sanhat. When you look very closely, it's very clear why Sanhat, what's up for you? Imaginary Homer, no water for you. Hatshepsut, now again, I think we can go here to our chair, and she, if you can just do a nice profile up slightly, just like that. You will see Hatshepsut here in the flesh, and it will be very clear why we don't hear Hatshepsut. When I say her name, people say, did you sneeze? Oh, bless you. I'm saying, no, I'm mentioning the name of one of the greatest women rulers, who also was one of the founders of African studies, which was African people studying ourselves, going to other African civilizations like Punt and studying ourselves and documenting Queen Ti, who ruled alongside Amenhotep when he got older. So you would address anything to Queen Ti. We don't hear about her, but we hear about Victoria. So water for Hatshepsut?
Yeah.
Water for Ti?
Yeah.
No water for Victoria. Akhenaten. Now, he was known as the Prince of Peace. He had these boundary stelae where he said, I will not go beyond this boundary. So Kemet actually lost land. Kemet was, it means land of the black people, right? Now why don't we hear about that name? We hear Egypt, because they hate telling you the original name. That's intentional. So Akhenaten, so he ended up losing ground that Ramesses II ended up gaining that ground back at the Battle of Kadesh. But that led to the world's first peace treaty, a copy of which is in the UN. So they know about it, but they're not telling you about it. So the inventor, the world's inventor of the peace treaty, we never heard his name, but we hear about Gandhi. This is him with his grandnieces that he used to sleep naked with to test his celibacy. You can read the South African Gandhi, Stretcher Bearer of Empire, The Doctor and the Saint about his later life, and then Gandhi behind the mask of divinity. So, water for Akhenaten?
Yeah.
Water for Ramesses II?
Yeah.
No water for Gandhi. Beresh Nefer, 380 to 300 BCE, what you're looking at is one of the world's first depictions of the world as round, carved in stone in the Metropolitan Museum. This is not missing, no one, this is not the secret, but they're deciding this is not going to get into your curriculum. This is the world as round, carved in stone. We don't hear about this, but we hear about Galileo. So water for Beresh Nefer?
Yeah.
No water for Galileo. Abubakar II, look at the image of this Afro on this African. He looks a bit like my graduate assistant, Nana Yao, over here. So when you look at this, we carved into boulders images that showed us with braids, with Afros, with all of our African features. And Mansa Musa said that's how he came to be the Mansa, is that his maternal uncle abdicated the throne to go across what at that time was known as the Ethiopian Ocean. So even Christopher Columbus, in his own journal, he said that's what the indigenous people said. They said we got these spear tips from the indigenous people there in the so-called New World. They said, yes, we got it from the Africans who've been here so many times before you did. That's Christopher Columbus saying this. But have we heard about Abubakar II? Have we heard of Christopher Columbus? Very clear why.
Yeah.
Gaspar Yanga, Ganga Zumba Zumbi Dos Palmares. These are the first free republics in the Western Hemisphere, no slavery. Now, George Washington, there's still slavery according to the 13th Amendment. All they have to do is say you committed a crime and slavery exists. Read the 13th Amendment. So our African ancestors,
yeah,
let's continue. Women warriors, Amani Shikenzo, who defeated the Romans, winning Jingambande, who fought against and defeated the Portuguese on many occasions. Water for them, no water for Joan of Arc.
Yeah.
Emperor Jean-Jacques Dessalines is the ruler of Haiti who defeated Napoleon. Now, have we heard of Napoleon? Why do you know the loser and you don't know the winner? So water for Dessalines.
Have you ever heard of Julius Caesar? Yes, I
have. Julius Caesar, yes, I have.
Julius Caesar, yeah.
I have.
Julius Caesar, yeah.
Oh, of course.
What of Imhotep?
No, I have no idea. Imhotep? I don't think so.
No, I have no idea.
What is that? No? No.
No, I haven't heard that.
So we've heard of Julius Caesar, but we haven't heard of Imhotep. This is right here on University of Ghana campus, right? Illustrating exactly what we're talking about. We'll move forward. So Carter G. Woodson says, those who have no record of what their forebears have accomplished lose inspiration, which comes from the teaching of biography and history. Carter G. Woodson, yeah. Let's continue. Renoko Rashidi says, what you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. What you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself, and what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. It's very clear through miseducation, diseducation, and anti-education that we haven't been told. So all of our thoughts that come about from that, we can be very clear on why we think what we think. And while if we say, it translates to knowing oneself is better than having someone tell us about ourselves. Let's move. So what we see is, sometimes they say, well, were the people in Kemet black? Well, just put them in front of white police officers, they will let you know very clearly. So while police kill the living, and this is from Florida up top, our pseudo-scholars kill the dead. So you see Namra, the founder of Kemet, right there in the bottom middle. You see Imhotep, you see Tutankhamun, you see all of our ancestors. They say you are not really dead until your name goes. Onipawa, Onwuye, right? But they are making sure that they are killing both our living, and then they are also killing our dead. Let's continue. Other contributors to Ghanaian society, Amon Gote, who was the designer of the Ghana coat of arms. We don't have a statue of him. He's passed away. Yao. Yeah. Theodosia Salome Oko. Yeah. This is the designer of the Ghana flag. Also Marcus Garvey, where we get the black star from, where we get the red, black, and green from. Yao. Yeah. Philip Weho, and also Michael Kwame Borjo, 1942 to present, but Philip Weho has passed away. Yao. Yeah. Let's continue. Where are their statues? Malcolm X said, no matter where the black man is, he will never be respected until Africa is a world power. Malcolm X, yeah. And we see, this is the African black man's respect in India. These are Africans confined to wheelchairs who've been beaten. Let's continue. But it's not only in India, and that's this year, but worldwide, we see in Libya, we see in Moscow, we see in Germany, we see in Florida. And then we also don't talk about the Eastern Hemisphere. Papua New Guinea, Chief Benny Wenda came all the way from Papua New Guinea to African Studies to beg for our assistance, because we don't think about the Africans who are there in the Pacific Islands, but we think about those who have passed away. Yeah?
Yeah.
And Malcolm X said, our problems are your problems. We have lived for over 300 years in that American den of racist wolves in constant fear of losing life and limb. Recently, three students from Kenya were mistaken for American Negroes and were brutally beaten by the New York police. And he says, if Africans are brutally beaten while only visiting in America, imagine the physical and psychological suffering received by your brothers and sisters who have lived there for over 300 years. Our problem is your problem. No matter how much independence Africans get here on the mother continent, unless you wear a national dress at all times while visiting America, you may be mistaken for one of us and suffer the same psychological and physical mutilation that is an everyday occurrence in our lives. And we saw that in Florida, getting shot in the head multiple times. Your problems will never be fully solved until and unless ours are solved. You will never be fully respected until and unless we are also respected. You will never be recognized as free human beings until and unless we are recognized and treated as human beings. Our problem is your problem. He says, it is not a Negro problem nor an American problem, it is a world problem. Let's continue as we wrap up. So Malcolm X, yeah. So self-respect and demands for respect. It's not only Gandhi must fall, it's the national anthem protest. Rose must fall. Black Lives Matter, save our name, the protests in India. Those who have been killed, yeah. And Black Lives Matter is not a new thing on social media. We see continuity. Emmett Till, look at his image. And Mimi Till said, when people saw what happened to my son, men stood up, and this is what happened to her son, left and right. So Emmett Till, yeah. Mimi Till, yeah. Ida B. Wells Barnett in 1892 said the only time that African people were not lynched is when they had a gun. So she's saying self-defense is what we're talking about. Ida B. Wells, and before we had social media, we had postcards where Europeans showed themselves burning African people and dismembering them and putting them in their heirloom collection. Ida B. Wells, yeah. And David Walker, in the 1820s, he had his appeal, 1830, matter of fact, where he said, now I ask you, had you not rather be killed than to be enslaved to a tyrant? That's David Walker, right? Yeah. And even before that, in the Eastern Hemisphere, you had the Zanz Rebellion. This is the first rebellion in the diaspora, which was African people rebelling against the Arabs. Yeah. And even before that, about 4,000 years ago, you had Winnie combining all of the different Africans and Nubians in order to fight against the Asiatics and keep them out of Kemet. Yeah. Let's continue. So, in terms of Black and African self-preservation, I'll conclude with this quote. We say, Akisho uri olori kia wodi agbetenilo. And it says, we do not guard the head of someone else so that the hawk will carry our own away. And this is what we say when we're even on a plane. We say, put the mask on yourself before assisting others. But so far, we can't breathe because we're trying to assist everyone else in the world, and we're not assisting ourselves. Let's finish. So in conclusion, Black, African, throughout space and time. Thank you very much.
Of time, I'm not going to go through the rest of my slides, but let me just point out to us that for those of us in the academy, there are some questions that we need to ask ourselves. So, how do we know what we believe about ourselves, about Africa, from all that we've talked about this morning and your own experiences? What epistemologies are employed? What methods do we use? What questions do we ask? Whose knowledge is scientific? What makes it legitimate? And how does what we learn interact with our own social context? As we go home and live in our homes, what we've learned, the theories, how does it interact with our social context? Does it make sense? And related to this, of course, is the question of academic freedom, what it really means. How do we access knowledge? How is it presented to us? How is it facilitated, both by our own universities and universities abroad? So in conclusion, in the overall conclusion, there are some things that we'd like to propose about and African studies. And when we're saying African studies, everything about what we learn in the African Academy in our lives as Black people here. And know that all that we've said indicates to us that knowledge is not value-free. It's not value-free. Whatever we learn, there is a value to it. And it's either positioning us one way or positioning us the other. Educating us or miseducating us or uneducating us. And silence is also not innocence. If you know and you hold that knowledge to yourself and you don't share it, there is no innocence in that. So we'd like to propose that a study of us and our people should recognize our diversity, but also our shared history and our contemporary realities. It's not a coincidence that Black lives are not mattering and being annihilated in different ways around the world. We should recognize the relationships among our realities and our contemporary experiences. We should actively seek to recognize, interrogate, and unsettle the hegemonies that we've been presented with. We should develop tools and methodologies relevant to our own context and include marginalized voices. We should go outside the classroom. The classroom presents us with tools and with skills. The internet is at our fingertips. We should be fact checkers and not just swallow everything that has been given to us. Somebody has said that education was to prepare students for life as a personal realization and as an essential element of progress and social change. And the author is Orr, 2004, and he declares that if we continue on the path that we are going, we are rather going to make our students effective vandals of the earth, unquote. We don't want to be vandals of the earth, and we don't want to be vandals of our own people. And so we hope that this discussion that we have not started, because this has been a discussion that's been going on for years, but this discussion that we've inserted into a journey that we are taking will lead to further discussions, but also, as Bob Marley said, to emancipation from mental slavery. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That is a lot. We cannot hope to have a really full conversation now because there's a lot. To have any questions or comments, you keep it to one question or comment and you make it very brief and then continue this conversation as we've heard elsewhere. Yes, so the mic will come to you The gentleman over here.
Thank you very much, Dr. Obadeli and Professor Dumama Obote. My name is Elaji and I'm a PhD student in the African Studies Department. And I really enjoyed the presentation. And the most important message I got was self-knowledge and systematic knowledge production about Africans in Africa. Now my question is, how can we achieve realistic results if we don't have anthropology departments in our national universities? Thank you.
Yes, over here.
First of all, I would like to thank
the speakers
for what a good delivery. I am Professor Ayeno, retired. Professor of Religion and Food Science, and co-founder and president of the African Renaissance Foundation, a foundation that seeks to re-educate the educated black man. And today, I saw a bit of it, trying to re-educate the educated black man. I came here because of one thing that is going on, a discussion about Gandhi and so forth. And I look at the thing and I said, oh, it is a matter of consciousness, African consciousness, the conscious and the non-conscious. The council said, no, no Gandhi. And the other side said, let's have Gandhi. Gandhi from South Africa was brought up to respect and fear the white man, to love the Indian, and to hate the black man. Then he went to Britain to do law, and he came back, sat in the train, coach. And in that coach, there were so many white men. And they asked him, this coach is not for you. Get out of this place. They sacked him from the coach. And then he said, I'm going to India to sack you, the British. And he did that. Probably he didn't have enough time to pay attention to the black. But this consciousness, it's what I would have to build.
Thank you.
And I'm glad that Dr. Kambon has begun teaching us about ourselves over 4,000 years.
Right.
And I support him for that.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Also, if you can say your affiliation, if you don't know who you are. Thank you. Or actually, everyone here doesn't know who everyone is, so say your affiliation.
Hi, good morning, and thanks to the organizers. My name is Kwaku. I describe myself as a history consultant. I'm London-based, by Ghanaian. Thanks to Christopher for the invitation. I'm going to point out something. I wonder how many people know that as a consequence of the Durban Conference on Racism, Xenophobia, we had 2011 as the year for people of African descent. We are now in the decade for people of African descent. That's a UN initiative. And indeed, I think next Friday I'm doing a program on that. And what we're talking about feeds into it.
Because you can intersect what the UN is doing. Oh.
That's the opportunity the UN has given us to be dissecting different levels. So I'll move on. Closely, you talked about value. Knowledge has value. What I like to say is that words have value. And in an institution like here, African Affairs, I think we've got to be very mindful of the language you use. Some of us choose to use enslave rather than slaves. And you said slave master. I remember my wife used to find support a charity based in Ghana. In 2007, when they were looking at the abolition, no, sorry, 50th anniversary of Ghana, they talked about the British being our colonial masters. We stopped working with them. Language is important. Not colonial masters, made enslaved. We've got to find language that puts us in a different perspective. Lastly, I think the doctor, sorry, you mentioned Nzinga, Queen Nzinga. When Queen Nzinga had a meeting with the Portuguese, the governor sat on a chair and the perspective was that she was subordinate. She sat on one of the lady waiters to make sure there was equality. So let's be mindful of not just decolonizing the academy, but the language that we use. Lastly, I bring you words of solidarity. This thing is very international. In England, we're not just looking at decolonizing the academy, we're looking at doing it in the museums all over the place. And lastly, let me tell you something, you need to have people helping you. Because there was a guy in the college, London College, he did it by himself and lost his job. So sometimes you need numbers together. So anyway, that's it. Thank you very much.
For advanced studies in Toulouse.
And thank you very much for
this very stimulating conversation.
A couple of years ago, I was working in the archives in Accra, and I came across this headline in the evening news, I think it was 1963, which read, "Help civilize American racialists." It was a Ghanaian protest against racial injustice. And so the comments, the call to have Africans or Ghanaians more interested in the welfare of African Americans in African Americans and other blacks elsewhere, I think it's a good call. The comment I want to make is about the actual interaction between Africans and African Americans. Those of you who have lived in the US especially would be familiar with the term Akata, which is a very charged one. There is some animosity, I think, between Africans and African Americans. My first year in the US was kind of shocking when I realized that. So I want to find out whether you don't think these kind of micro tensions affect the ways in which scholarship is done. And I attended the same university as Nanepia. And what I realized was that the African American Studies Department and the African Studies Program don't interact. So, you know, ways of bridging this gap.
Thank you. I will bypass the comments. We are very grateful for that those contributions to the discussion, and we'll just address the two clear questions about the Department of Anthropology and Kofi Asante's questions about African-Americans and African relations.
I'll take the latter one first, Kofi's question. In my recent sabbatical year spent in the US, I was at a school where on one evening I was invited to a spoken word event, and there's a young woman originally from Cameroon and a young African-American man, and they did a spoken word that spoke exactly to what you're saying. And at the beginning of the presentation, she's referring to him as Akata, and he's referring to her as, you know, that ignorant black woman from Africa. And as they take us through the event, they come to a point where they realize that they are, you know, African and African-American lives equal each other, and that we have to work together. But it's the ignorance that we have about each other that lead to those animosities. And I, from my experience in the past 2-3 years, because there are a number of young people in my life who have been all over the world, I see that the younger generation are trying to build those bridges, are trying to help the larger black community understand that our lives are bound together. And these artificial differences have been created by other people to disinform us and to, you know, disunite us and to divide us. So I find it hopeful that these conversations are going on. And when you go online, there are a number of blogs and young people in social media, and particularly in performance, spoken word and music, who are bridging those gaps. And it's not possible to mention all those names. So that's what I'll say about that. And here in Ghana, it behoves us also to try to bridge those gaps.
because each of us, we have this sense of arrogance that, you know, those other people are a certain kind of people and they've had a certain kind of experience, and we, the Africans, are the ones who are serious and we study and we get our lives together, and we've allowed Hollywood to also misinform us. So once you have a bit of knowledge, you've got to build build upon it. As far as anthropology is concerned, as somebody who studied architecture and development planning and sociology, perhaps this is not a fair comment to make, but I don't think that the discipline, you know, it's not about the disciplines. It's not about the disciplines that we study. There's a reason why we don't study anthropology in Lagos. When this university moved out of its colonial location, Kwame Nkrumah decided that the way that anthropology had been constructed as a discipline, going from the, you know, with this voyeuristic view to go and study other people, this curiousness about those strange non-white peoples, it wasn't going to happen at Lagos. And that was the thinking behind not having anthropology here as a discipline. Should we do anthropology today? After all, anthropology has moved on as a discipline. I don't know, maybe that's a discussion that we should have. But it's not just, you know, it's not just anthropology. Each of the disciplines have been colonized. It's not just anthropology. Each of the disciplines have been colonized. And each of the disciplines, as far as I'm concerned, need to be decolonized. I mean, we need to study things with methods and with questions that inform our own reality and that move us to a place of liberation.
Okay, very briefly, I studied anthropology. You should, I would recommend that everyone read Ayukwe Alma. He has several texts, including Eloquence of the Scribes, Remembering the Dismembered Continent. But he actually goes into those same origins of anthropology and how it was used systematically. Anthropology for primitive people, sociology for Europeans. So, you know, going into what all of those types of divisions were about. What I would recommend is what I call, or what's referred to as Sebaït Kemet, which is what we could say is Kemetology, that all of these, all this information that we don't know about, the first one to do this, the first one to do that, we don't know any precedents of things that African people have done, so therefore we just go get into, all right, out of all these white people, who are the nicest ones? All right, let's choose Marx, let's choose the Indo-Aryan Alliance, Gandhi, all right, let's go with this. So if we know what we've done, then we can start selecting, you know, better. Also, in terms of the train coach incident, I wanted to mention this. G.B. Singh, he talks about in his book, Gandhi on the Cross, Examination 2009, that the train coach incident never ever happened, and how Gandhi gave conflicting accounts of what supposedly happened at different points in time. So this 1893 train coach incident did not happen, so look into that as well. You can't just go with anything that was seen in a movie. Read the original source text and find out where Gandhi tripped up and a lie. You know, no crap. If you have one mouth, you can tell when it's true. Also, to back up what Prof. Marco Ampofo said, this is divide and conquer. I grew up in the United States with an African name, so I got it both ways. So people call me African Booty Scratcher every day. And then, you know, from the other side, basically, what we see in the U.S. is that Africans have flies on their face and distended bellies, and they're all starving. They live in jungles. You never want to associate with Africa. What we get here is that Africans, they are all drug dealers, pimps, and pushers. Where Akata, this is actually a word for a jackal, because in the 70s, when you see them with fur coats moving like this, that's actually a Yoruba word. So all of this is based on divide and conquer, that we never sit down and understand, oh, who taught me this about you? Who taught me this about you? Oh, they did it for their ultimate benefit. They understand, which translates to two small antelopes beat a big one. They know this, so as long as they can keep this antelope fighting against that antelope, they will never challenge the current, the past, current, and future enemies that we have. And then finally, on the mental slavery piece, I was very careful to use mental slavery because that is the one that's actually slavery. If you're just in physical, that one is enslavement. You understand, you're in a condition, but you, at any point in time, you're saying, I'm gonna get out of this as soon as possible. But the more sinister, and I'm quoting or paraphrasing, the more sinister one is the mental slavery. This is where, even if there's no chain on you, you will just sit and stay placed. So the cow grazes where it is tied, and we are not cows. Let's move.
Okay, what I'm gonna do, we can't take any more questions, but this is what I'm going to say. Turn to the person next to you or behind you. I'm sure you have some thoughts. I learned this in another conference and it works very well. It gives you a chance to say the things that you want to say to somebody else and have them listen. So take 30 seconds and talk say what you want to say to the person next to you for 30 seconds. I'm giving you that opportunity.
Now, formerly this was known as a Ghana must go bag. From now on, this is a Gandhi must go bag. So this is our Gandhi statue, and we want to say, in the spirit of Gandhi must go, away!
So go ahead, say what you need to say to the person next to you, what you've learned, a question you had. Let's start the conversation. Oh, I didn't say leave. Okay, well, since people are getting up to go, let me thank, can I get your attention? All right, can we take a second to thank Professor Aduma Kwankwanko and Dr. Akambo for their presentation. And shall we give another applause to African Institute of Affairs? And final applause to you for being engaged and awake and for all the questions asked, those that usually get a chance to ask. Kofi Asante just asked me to mention that he's giving a talk tomorrow.
On a very similar topic
tomorrow at 9 a.m. at the Sociology Department. I would recommend that you go. He is fantastic. And I'll now hand over to Jean.
Thank you. So just reminders, a few announcements. If you didn't sign, first of all, again, thank you. Thank the presenters, thank the chair, and thank you all for coming out. We do apologize that we weren't able to take more questions, but hopefully next week we'll be able to resolve that contradiction. Please, if you did not sign in, we really need you to sign in. There's three books outside, one for the public, one for staff, and one for students. So please make sure you do that. Again, please like us on both Facebook and Twitter. That's Thursday seminar. Again, that's Thursday seminar. Just Google it on both Facebook and Twitter. And then next week, hopefully you all will be here next week. So if you're not here and I see you somewhere on campus, I'm gonna get you. So next week, our correct title is Challenging Environmental Problems in Emerging Cities in Ghana, Institutional Arrangement versus Community Initiative in Techiman. Dr. Usman Alassan and Dr. Irene will be part of that panel. We'll also have a couple students as well. So we welcome you to come as well. Please check out our Institute of African Studies, University of Ghana YouTube account. We do have the audio up from last week's presentation. We have the video up from the first presentation on September 15th, and we hope to get this audio up soon. Thank you again. See you next Thursday.